The Academy Award crowns Miss Gay America.
And we talk with a few political notables, these stories and more on this edition of Gay Spectrum. Welcome to Gay Spectrum, the cable feature magazine that reflects our community and its activities. I'm Eric Randall.
And I'm Angela Judy. Each week we bring you the personalities and events of interest to gays and lesbians. Inside Outside the Beltway started its second season here in Washington. To celebrate the event, Dennis Brooks, the show's executive producer, held a premiere party at the Hung Jury, where he previewed some of the upcoming shows.
Tonight to our gala premiere of Inside Outside the Beltway. Yes. We have come to tag it as the soap opera with a lavender twist. And indeed it is looking at life with lavender colored glasses on. We're thrilled that we're starting our second season. Perhaps some of you saw it's our first season. If not, you'll have the opportunity to preview tonight. We are proud that we have already won two awards. One for the, yes. So much for spontaneity. I do have my notes here. I knew this spontaneous stuff could only last for about 1 minute. We won the Best Director of an Entertainment Series and the Best Entertainment Series for the Local Comedy Awards last year.
So Dennis, you're coming up on your third year.
That's right.
As director, executive producer, and all that good stuff for Inside Outside the Beltway. How's it feel?
Exhausting. Exciting, yeah. Exhilarating. I couldn't believe it that we've been on the air now for 2 years. We're going into our second season, and we're soon to start a third.
Now, you indicated during this gala premiere of the third season that you guys are just about to break out of the D.C. metropolitan area or outside the Beltway. Let's
yes.
talk a little bit about that.
We've been actively pursuing other markets in other cities, such cities as St. Louis, San Diego, Miami, and New York, of course, and even Canada. Even now as we're speaking, the tape is on its way to Tokyo, and I've sent a tape to the United Kingdom.
So what goes into putting on a production like this? I mean, you do this, it's a program that comes on weekly. It must take an awful lot of time. It must take an awful lot of commitment. How do you get the energy? Where do you find the energy? Where does your cast find the energy?
Dedication. Everybody is so dedicated and so talented, and the scripts are so good. I mean, I have a talented team of writers and an extremely gifted crew. People just put it together. They see that it's a worthy idea, and they're just committed to the idea, and they're dedicated to a cause. And I think more than anything, I mean, we all go home exhausted, but we know that we're together on this idea.
Carrington, you write for the show. Talk about where you come up with the ideas for a lot of your characters. How you develop those characters.
Real life is a wonderful place from which to draw on fiction. And I believe that most of the characters in my storyline, which revolves around a television station and the various players that come and go in the public eye, has a little bit to do with my own life. I was a radio newscaster for 3 years, and that environment, I think, is very ripe for presenting the conflict between the personal and the professional. It's no coincidence that my lead storyline, which is Vicky St. Clair, the up-and-coming, quick-witted, and very difficult head newscaster for WLAM News, it's no coincidence that indeed she is a newscaster, and that she has a lot of problems coping with personal versus professional. I believe I'm an observer of life and watch people closely and feel that Inside Outside the Beltway is an excellent forum to portray character. And it has so much richness, and that we are dealing not only with gays and lesbians and bisexuals, but also with straight reality, because indeed we are not an isolated community. We are one that that interacts and interweaves with our straight brothers and sisters, and I think that's part of the beauty of the show.
Michelle, you've got a lot of problems in your character.
Vicky
has a lot of problems.
Despite the fact that people say I'm typecast, but I'm sure that's not true.
Let's talk about Vicky and her problems. Yes, explain your character.
I think Vicky's an example of a person who, if you don't live your life from your heart, things start going screwy in your life. And I think there's a lot of that going on. We don't know what her problem is until, you know, we get to know her. But she's definitely an example of things not going right in her heart and things going really screwy in her life. She likes the pony. She likes to drink. She likes to beat up on the weaker sex, the male persuasion. And
now, as a news reporter, from what I saw in the premiere here this evening, it indicated that you were at your best when you were ready to pounce, when somebody's in the chair and you're going after the jugular. Now, do you have experience as a reporter or a journalist? How does that come naturally for you?
Well, I have worked in media. In fact, I worked on Gay Fairfax for 2 years as a co-anchor and an interviewer. And Vicky has an interesting combination of persuasion, charisma, and you really see her going for the jugular when behind the scenes. You don't see it on camera.
Now, is alcoholism, loneliness, because I think it's something that's apparent for someone who is extremely successful, as Vicky apparently is in the series. Are those problems of individuals who reach a certain amount of success and they don't want to share it with someone? Is that something you're working through as Vicky?
I think Vicky reaches for the bottle because she can't reach for anyone else. I mean, there's a real void in her personal life, and she fills it with excitement. She fills it with a racetrack. She fills it with, you know, numbing herself out, drinking, and working really, really hard. You see her very successful, and she's good at what she does, but she's not well-rounded as a person, and you see her struggling with that.
Your character, like the show, has been developing since it started 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. When I first saw the show, you were dealing with coming out. How has Phil evolved over the past 3 years?
Well, he's actually at a point now where he's only semi-comfortable with being out. He still hasn't had what I like to call his first experience. This is the first time he's lived with gay male roommates. And so he actually is still being confronted with coming out, because as you'll see, I haven't actually come out to my parents yet. So we'll probably be dealing with that. But Phil is still like in what I call a transition period of coming out. He hasn't completely come out because he still isn't completely comfortable being gay.
Do you have any input as the actor as to the direction that Phil's character is going to move in as the show progresses?
Somewhat. I haven't had a lot of input this time around because Dennis and Jody, who's the writer for my storyline, have had definite directions they want Phil to go in. I, however, am kind of hoping that when the third season rolls along that things will get brighter, because Phil's life has been kind of hard.
So when you say brighter, do you mean that Phil gets laid or Phil gets a boyfriend?
I'm hoping for at least a boyfriend. That ought to be a start in the right direction. And just Phil to be a generally happier person. I'm happy and comfortable with being gay. I'm hoping my Phil character will work up to that point too.
We're very, very pleased that the mayor of our fair city has sent an envoy tonight, Steve Miller.
Steve, what significance do you think the mayor sending a representative to this premiere for Inside Outside the Beltway shows as it relates to her commitment to the gay community, gay and lesbian community?
Well, you know, Mayor Kelly has always been very out front and very supportive of the gay and lesbian community in Washington, D.C. She participated in a march on Washington. She believes in that the one of the strengths of our city is its diversity and its vibrant gay and lesbian community. So she's very supportive and was honored to send me, and I'm honored to be here. Secondly, it's a film and it's a motion picture, and one of the big economic emphasis of the mayor's office is to promote the film industry, and this is the gay sector of the film industry is very important. More and more people in our city and our country are becoming more aware of the contributions of gay and lesbians and the role that they play, and this is a good way to sort of spread it.
Now, you saw the premiere here tonight at the first show for this season. What'd you think?
It was good. It was good. Better than most of the stuff that I see on TV. And one thing I noticed, that there wasn't any violence and some of the stuff that you see a lot of. So it seemed like it was a very positive show.
Now, how important do you think a film such as this, as you call it, or a soap opera such as this, is in promoting positive images of gays and lesbians in what they deal with in day-to-day life? I mean, I think the straight community views the gay community as this sexual thing.
Sure.
And what you saw here tonight was not sexual at all.
It was just real people. And I think that's the message that has to be gotten out more and more. I mean, I think the larger community does not really understand gay and lesbian people except through the stereotypes, and this sort of film helps to sort of deal with that, and I think that's helpful.
Well, we're glad you came out.
Glad to be here. Wish them the best of success, and I hope it's a success, and I think it says also a lot because this video is being shot in Washington. It says a lot about our city. We have a lot to be proud of. We have a very rich and vibrant gay and lesbian community, and we're very proud of it. I'm proud to be a member of that community, and so I think it's significant this is going to be airing across the country, and we probably, once again, Washington, D.C. is going to be on the map.
Now, you've got a couple of characters. You've got characters who were dealing with coming out.
Mm-hmm.
You have an individual who is HIV positive.
Yes.
You deal with some real life issues. Mm-hmm. Is it difficult to write for parts like that?
Very.
Do you get help from people who are in those positions?
You as a writer, you work from your own experience. You also go out and do research because you have to be honest to the ideas and to the people and to the characters that you're portraying. Otherwise, it just doesn't come across that way in the camera, because every false move is just blown up.
Yeah. Thanks for joining us.
Thank
you. Good luck.
Thank you.
When we return, an interview with Joycelyn Elders and the Miss Gay America DC pageant.
Rubber.
Raincoat.
Sombrero.
Pocket pouch.
Umbrella.
Preservatif. Rubber ducky.
Condongo.
Jimmy.
Life jacket.
Sleeve.
Prophylactic.
Camisinas.
Homie hood.
Cover.
Gumi.
Preservativo.
Love glove.
Condom. It doesn't matter what you call it. Wear it. This condom reminder has been brought to you by the AIDS program of Whitman Walker Clinic.
Thousands of people turned out to help Whitman Walker raise over $1.25 million during AIDS Walk Washington back in September. The clinic staff, while happy about the turnout, was even more pleased with support it received from political leaders. Spectrum was there, and we talked to Jim Graham on that rainy but uplifting day.
I noticed that you had a lot of important people here today.
Yeah, we did. It's good.
From the administration.
Right.
And I guess after coming off of 12 years of Republican administration, you didn't get that much participation, but today was amazing. I mean, Tipper Gore,
right.
Joycelyn Elders.
Yes.
I mean, it was just amazing.
Christine Gebbie. And then we had members of Congress. We had a very good representation from the metropolitan area. It's a good sign. You know, we've waited a long time for a White House which had a real interest interest in what we were doing. And I think we have that today. I mean, I don't want to suggest there aren't problems with this administration, because there are, but they're feeling their way, and I think they're essentially with us.
Could you tell me why you're here today lending support to the Whitman Walker's Aid Walk?
Well, I'm here because so many people are HIV positive, and I think they deserve respect, love, and support. They are our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers, and I think that a lot can be done to educate the public about AIDS and AIDS-related diseases. I support this clinic because it's been so wonderful for people who are HIV positive, and I want to help, you know, raise the money for the clinic. But more importantly, I want to say that people with HIV positive, people who are HIV positive deserve respect, love, and support from the community.
If you could deliver one message to the United States as a representative to some degree for the government, what would you tell people, considering the government has been quiet for quite some time on the issue of AIDS?
Well, we can't afford to be quiet. AIDS is an epidemic that affects people of both sexes. It affects people from every walk of life. In fact, the fastest growing HIV positive results in some areas are with adolescents in ages 15 to 24. AIDS is spreading with women. And I think most people don't realize that. We need to find a cure, number one. We need more money dedicated to research to find the cure. But in the meantime, we don't need to be ignorant and afraid of AIDS. We need to understand it, we need to face it, and we need to offer love and support and understanding to those people who are living with it.
Thank you very much.
I had the opportunity to talk to Congresswoman Connie Morrella about her sponsorship of AIDS legislation to benefit women.
It's the fastest growing group of people to get AIDS, and young women in particular. And I have legislation that deals with research, deals with outreach and prevention. It's an area where we need to do far more research. We need to do more in terms of offering to women one-stop shops for education, for prevention, for assistance that they need. And I'm pleased also that Whitman Walker, as they look to their community of needs, are not omitting women either.
Newly appointed Surgeon General Dr. Joycelyn Elders maintained her commitment to protecting people by promoting the use of condoms.
I will continue to support the use of condoms and for the protection, since it's all we've got now. We don't have a vaccine, we don't have a drug to treat this disease, so we've got to prevent it. And condoms is the best means we have. We will be putting out a promotion of condoms, and the mass media has got to help us. They have a responsibility to help promote condoms on national TV. We promote everything else, and this is something that could save the lives of our people.
Perhaps the most visible symbol of the Clinton administration's commitment to fighting this disease has been the appointment of Christine Gebbie as the AIDS czar. I talked to Gebbie about her role.
My job is to give a voice to this epidemic on behalf of the administration, on behalf of all the people of this nation, to say we all have to respond if we're going to get ahead of it, each in our own way, but we have to be there. That's the more public part of the job. The other part is inside the federal government to make sure we get the biggest bang out of every buck we spend, whether it's on research or treatment or on prevention.
How is the administration going to ensure that the money is channeled in the right direction?
Well, we've got some new activities with communities, letting communities set their own priorities. They're doing that now around treatment with the Ryan White Act, trying to find ways for that to happen around prevention, trying to find new ways for people infected and affected by the epidemic to speak directly to me so that we know what they need.
What role do you think Whitman Walker plays in the government's efforts, and how will Whitman Walker play a role in your efforts?
Well, Whitman Walker is one of a network of clinics across this country that have been at the heart of the treatment activity and at the heart of prevention. And if we didn't have those clinics in our cities that had stepped up to the mark around this epidemic from the beginning, been open about the need to care, been open about the need to deal with this disease, we would be even farther behind than we are. Their voice, their commitment, their sponsorship of events like this is critical to where we're going.
As the AIDS czar, what one message would you like to send to the American public about this epidemic?
Don't be afraid of the disease, be afraid of your own ignorance. Get out here and join us.
It certainly was a welcome change to hear representatives from the administration talk of the need to find a cure and to make the public more aware of how to prevent the spread of this devastating disease.
And now for the total. $1,250,000. Thank you, Washington.
You know, speaking of AIDS and AIDS awareness, December 1st is World AIDS Day.
That's right, it is.
And to do our part, we here at Spectrum are making available, free of charge, to the first 50 people who send us a self-addressed stamped envelope, a pin commemorating the postage stamp being issued by the U.S. Postal Service.
To get your free pin, write us here at Gay Spectrum, care of FCAC, Channel 10, 2929 Eskridge Road, Suite S, Fairfax, Virginia, 22031.
Finally tonight, the Academy Awards of Washington held the Miss Gay America DC pageant here at the Convention Center. The head of that organization, Mame Dennis, joined us on one of our field shoots for Neighborhood Focus. Neighborhood Focus is truly out in the neighborhood this evening. We are at the DC Convention Center, where the Academy Awards of Washington is putting on its ninth annual Miss Gay America pageant. Joining us this evening is Mame Dennis, president of the Academy. Thanks for joining us here today.
Thank you for coming and being with us.
Well, tell me about this pageant that's going on tonight.
Well, our pageant tonight is a takeoff on the real Miss America pageant. Our contestants pick states. They compete in swimsuit, evening gown, talent, and everything is done on the runway, just very Atlantic City. They probably work just as hard as the real girls do to get the title. It's a lot is involved.
How much effort goes into putting on tonight's pageant?
Well, it takes months. It's the biggest thing we do. We anticipate about 600 people here this evening. You can see some of the props around us. Nothing happens overnight. These contestants have worked, most of them, all summer.
Now, the Academy in and of itself is not does not just gear itself to putting on events such as this. It's more of a social organization.
Well, yeah, we're very social. The whole thing was set up to be, was to be social. But also, last year the Academy was voted a position on the Brother Help Thyself board, which is a charity organization, and it's the first time that a drag group has been accepted as a member in this leather organization. We do a lot of fundraising. Last year we did a Rhinestone review at Tracks. We earned $5,000. It's November 21st this year at Tracks. If you want to come, we'd love to have you. And our goal is $7,000. And we, in addition to that, we work very hard to support the clinic, the Whitman Walker Clinic, and everything that the clinic is doing.
Now, when you get together as a social group, everybody is known by a particular stage name. No one uses their real name, is that correct?
Basically, we all use stage names, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what do you talk about in these get-togethers that you all have? The latest in cosmetics, the latest in hairsprays?
Yeah, when we there's a place called Club 55. It's at 55 K Street in the D.C. And we have our shows every Sunday, practically, there. That's more of a drag function and not quite as social. But we have meetings during the month that are broken up into the houses. And there we talk about what's going on, what somebody's doing, what help they need. We're very supportive of each other. Even tonight, nothing that you're going to see, nothing that's happening is done by one person. Each person has a team of people that help them.
Now, I've got a question. How long does it take you to get fully dolled up for an event like tonight?
Well, I used to do my makeup years ago. I don't anymore. Ella Fitzgerald does my makeup and she does my hair. It takes her about an hour.
So it's a time-consuming process.
Yeah, it's a transformation.
Now, you indicated, you know, I said, what is the fascination in the gay community with drag? And we were talking a little bit about that early on before we started taping. What is the fascination? And you had some pretty good insight about that.
I guess you could take a person like me who's older. When we started doing this, it was very theatrical. That's the type of drag that I do. It's a theatrical drag. The newer people, the younger people, they want this transformation. They have this very real look. They don't wear all this big hair and not all this eye makeup and everything. It's a very real thing for them. They want to look like a woman. We don't even try to. I don't look like no woman that I ever saw.
So we're back at the pageant. You've got your contestants. Now, how many contestants are there tonight?
We have eight. We have eight contestants.
Eight contestants. Yeah. What are they going to do? What are the performances? Do you know anything about that? What do they win? Do they get a crown? Do they get a scholarship? What?
Tonight, the Miss America gets a crown, and she gets a $1,000 prize. First prize is $1,000.
So, as president, what do you do? You reign supreme over your house?
Well, I guess I reign supreme over the whole group. I do make the final says, but I don't do anything by myself. I have a lot of people that I've been associated with for 20 years. We've been all in it together, Fanny and Patty and Frank and different ones, Lainie. We've been friends for 20 years. We've done this for 20 years together.
Well, Mame Dennis, we thank you for taking time out of this busy pageant schedule of yours. We're going to go out and take a look at some of the events
that
are going on.
Good. That's great. And if anybody can come November 21st down to Tracks, we'd love to have you because that's a very worthwhile cause and we're trying to do $7,000.
Well, I'm sure we'll be there and we thank you for stopping by and
seeing us. Thank you. Nice to meet you.
Bye-bye.
Well, that wraps this edition of Gay Spectrum. Remember to check the Washington Blade and other papers for days and times that we can be seen in your area. I'm Angela Judy.
We hope that Spectrum has enlightened you to the diversity that's part of our community. I'm Eric Randall. For all of us here, have a good week. Welcome to Gay Spectrum, the cable feature magazine that reflects our community and its activities. I'm Eric Randall. What was that?
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I'm ready.
Oh. Gay Spectrum is made possible in part by Lambda Rising, the bookstore for lesbians and gay men, their families and friends in Washington, Baltimore, and Rehoboth Beach.